To Writers on Writing, I'm your host, Brenda Greene, Executive Director of the Center for Black Literature at Meg Rivers College and Director of the National Black Writers Conference. Writers on Writing comes to you each Sunday and provides you, our listening audience, with an opportunity to hear writers from throughout the African diaspora talk about their work, their craft, and their lives. And I'm very, very pleased to have on the telephone with me today Professor Elizabeth Alexander.
Hello, welcome, Professor Greene. I'm excited to be talking to you today.
Oh, I'm very excited and very privileged to talk to you. You have been a visitor at Meg Rivers College, but I think this is our first radio interview.
Yes.
And it's really exciting. Your name came up a couple of days ago as part of the Juneteenth Book Festival, and one of your famed admirers, Ethelbert Miller.
Oh, Ethelbert.
E. Ethelbert Miller.
Ethelbert.
Yes, is talking about you. But I'm really excited that you can talk about primarily your most recent book, The Light of the World, a memoir that I just found. It's the kind of book that you go back to and think about, and I would read something and stop and think. So I'm really, really pleased to be able to talk to you about it and for you to share with us what that was like for you.
Well, this is a book that I never imagined I would write for many reasons.
Right.
Of course, the book was occasioned by the completely unexpected and sudden loss of my beloved husband, Fikre Ghebreyesus, who 3 years ago passed away very unexpectedly from cardiac arrest. So the earth was pulled out from under me and out from under my children, and in the wake of that, surviving and figuring out how to move forward, I was quite surprised that writing was a part of that. I would write a word, a phrase, a snippet, as a way of knowing that the earth was solid underneath me and as a way of perceiving what was happening to me. And that eventually led to more and more and more phrases piled upon phrases. They felt like they came the same way that poems came, and I realized that it was another kind of thing that I did want to share. So writing memoir, writing in the first person, saying, this is me, these are my children, this is my business, this is my real life, I think I haven't hidden behind the artifice of poems, but I think that writing poems has made me feel safer and more protected in a way than putting myself all the way out there in this book. But the response has told me that it is that honesty that is what connects with other human beings.
That's right. I'm going to stop for a moment because I want to share with our listening audience some background information about you. And you are the author of 6 books of poetry, including American Sublime, which was a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize, 2 collections of essays, The Black Interior and Power and Possibility. And you also composed and recited Praise Song for the Day for the 2009 inauguration of President Barack Obama. So you write in a variety of genres. And this memoir, I think, even as you were describing it, really illustrates how you are a natural storyteller and how you blend in your speech prose and poetry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, you know, it's interesting because I do write. I love stories, and I think that the reason that I became a writer is that I love listening to the people around me tell stories. I loved listening to the different ways that my mom and dad, both from Harlem with very different ways of expressing themselves, the different ways and ranges that they use the language. One of my grandfathers came from Jamaica to Harlem, and listening to his vocabulary, the particulars of that, the way he would tell stories about coming and going in diaspora and the circles to which we belong, and the same thing from my grandmother, who came originally from Selma via and then Washington, D.C., and then made her way to New York. You know, these migrants, these travelers that are my people, told their stories in the way that, you know, we are all of us the products of varying forms of Black migration, and if what would we do if we didn't have those stories? So I think that my poems have always been a place for them. My teaching has always been a place for them. But I think that in memoir, the pull of narrative and the need to tell a story is more pointed, and I have definitely enjoyed kind of exercising that.
Right. And it also takes a lot of courage to tell that. I'm sure it took a lot of courage for you to share this story.
Well, you know, isn't it funny? I mean, I think that... as mothers, as you know, you just do what you have to do. And I didn't think that anything I did was particularly courageous. I just thought, I'm trying to keep walking forward one step at a time with my children and to keep them squared away and solid. They were 12 and 13 when they lost their father. And to keep his memory not just alive, but alive in the way that I think so many of us believe that our ancestors are really with us, you know, in the day-to-day. So I look back and think, okay, you know, you held it together and you move forward and you put this writing out there, and I would describe it as courageous in someone else. But in myself, I just feel I did what I had to do and what I was supposed to do and what millions of women do every day.
Well, I commend you for saying that, but I also want to reiterate that because of the way you told it and the detail that you gave in capturing certain moments of your talks together and cooking and walking around and supporting each other really, really provided a very, very moving portrait of what love is like. And how important it is to value relationships and value the people around you and value those experiences.
Well, thank you. I loved that I had writing as a tool with which to remember and fix some of those beautiful memories. I felt like that was just a blessing to have that tool, to have that practice. And I really do think that, you know, the everyday rituals are what our lives are made out of. And so I love reading about the way people live and talk and eat and share and make intimacy. And I wanted to talk about intimacy between two people who fell in love, but also intimacy within a family, intimacy within a Black family. That where, you know, we came from different parts of the diaspora. Fikre, my late husband, came from Eritrea. And so bringing together aspects of both of our cultures in our intimate space and nurturing that in our rituals and in our everyday was just a beautiful, beautiful way to live. And I'm glad that for readers, but also for my kids, that some of that is fixed in this book.
Yes, it is. Why don't you share with us some passages from the book?
I would love to.
The Light of the
and
World.
I talk about this book as being a poet's prose.
Yes.
So the chapters are very small. The book is in five sections with many, many small chapters in each section, and it moves through time, forward and backward, in the way that I think we experience time and memory, not in a straight line, but, you know, sort of memory rushes in even as we move forward. So this is from the beginning. The story seems to begin with catastrophe, but in fact began earlier and is not a tragedy, but rather a love story. Perhaps tragedies are only tragedies in the presence of love, which confers meaning to loss. loss is not felt in the absence of love. The queen died and then the king died is a plot, wrote E.M. Forster in The Art of the Novel. But the queen died and then the king died of grief is a story. It begins on a beautiful April morning when a man wakes exhausted and returns to sleep in his beloved 13-year-old son's trundle bed, declaring, "This is the most comfortable bed I have ever slept in." Or it begins when the wife says goodbye to the man a few hours later, walking in front of his car, switching her hips a bit, a blown kiss as she heads to her office, and he continues on to his painting studio. Or the story begins as he packs a tote bag, off to his studio for a day of painting, then home, as if nothing extraordinary has happened when in fact he has been envisioning worlds, hanging his bag on a hook in the mudroom and changing out of his paint-splattered jeans into gym shorts and a t-shirt for yoga in the family room or a run on the treadmill in the basement. Soon the two children will walk down Edge Hill Road from the bus stop like burros under their knapsacks, and his wife will prepare dinner while listening to Thelonious Monk's evocative open intervals and sipping from a glass of white wine that he's opened and poured for her. "My frosty white?" she'd ask a few times a week, and he'd chuckle and say, "Right away, my love, chop, chop." Mm-hmm. They enjoyed playing and acting out boy-girl courtliness. The 13-year-old does his homework, and the 12-year-old practices his drumming. The man's home life is the unchanging, beautiful same, so anything could occur in the painting studio each day. I am the wife. I am the wife of 15 years. I am the plumpish wife, the pretty wife, the loving wife, the smart wife, the American wife. I am eternally his wife. Perhaps the story begins with the 36 lottery tickets he bought 2 days before he died, which I discovered weeks later when they fluttered out of the pages of one of the many books he was reading. Or it begins with his surprise 50th birthday party 4 days before he died, and the spoken tributes from his loved ones and strawberries and pancakes and music the next morning. Or it began when I met him 16 years before. That was always a good story, an actual coup de foudre, a bolt of lightning, love at first sight. I felt a visceral torque, I would tell people, a literal churn of my organs, not butterflies, not arousal, rather a not unpleasant rotation of my innards as never before. Lightning struck and did not curdle the cream, but instead turned it to sweet silken butter. Lightning turned sand into glass. The story began in the winter of 1961, when two quietly mighty women were each pregnant, one in Asmara, Eritrea, the other in Harlem, USA, one with her sixth child, one with her first. The East African sun would arrive on March 21, 1962, the most hallowed day of the zodiac. It is the beginning and the end of the astrological calendar, and so it is said that children born on March 21st are ancient souls who possess the wonder and innocence of newborns. The American child, a girl, would come on May 30th into the chatter and buzz of Gemini in Gotham.
Mm.
So that's the first little chapter.
Right, beautiful. And you just, again, reiterated how you bring in so many themes about parent-child relationships, about your spirituality and religion, and what it's like to be a mother and a wife. switching back, one of the things that I think the memoir also talks about is the life of the artist, the nature of the artist. You, on page 17, say, "Painting was the miracle, the final act of defiance through which I exercise the pain and reclaim my sense of place, my moral compass, and my love for life." And speaking of your husband, how art was so important. And I think that epitomizes what the role of the artist is.
I'm very, very glad and realizing how important it is to have chronicled not only the life of a particular painter, of a couple, the two of us committed, a black couple committed to making art as our way in the world, making poetry and making painting, but also to a first generation African, or as my children say, African-American, for whom art is the political way, for whom art is both a soul necessity but also a way to put forward cultural values, to say, you know, this is my beloved country and culture, even though right now it is at war and under siege. Figre spent many of his early years after he became a refugee during the Eritrean War for Liberation as an activist organizing young people around issues around the war and the East African famine. He always painted. He worked for a long time also as a chef in a restaurant called Café Adulis that he and his brothers owned and ran. But I think to show how art was the way of spreading culture and bringing change and justice, and that he had that daily devotion and practice, and what it took to be that person, what it took to believe in and commit to and make that art, tied up with a sense of cultural identity. You know, that's what he did so admirably, and so I'm glad that you asked me about that, because that's a really important part of the book for me.
Yes, and I thought about the, you know, value of asking, to what extent do you write as an artist or as a Black artist? I didn't even have to ask that because it came through so clearly. And you also talk about, you bring up what happens to Black men in this country. Black men die more catastrophically across class than anyone else in America.
Yeah.
So you're making a statement about the need to take care of ourselves and the healing and how that often does not happen in
Absolutely.
Our families.
Absolutely. And for Figre, he was, and I spoke to, we did not know that his arteries were almost completely blocked. He lived an extremely healthy life, yoga, blueberries, flaxseed, headstands, exercise, but he was a smoker. And he tried very, 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 very hard from the moment I met him. I don't think a day passed that he did not attempt to quit smoking, but it had its grip on him. And several doctors who I spoke to afterwards talked about, you know, cumulative stress and trauma, which in his case, you know, to leave with, you know, soldiers breaking into your home, to walk
Yes.
through killing fields. He literally walked out of his country, to remake yourself in several countries. And then to come to a country where you have to deal with what it means to be a Black man in other people's eyes. You know, I mean, this is an African man who obviously always knew he was a Black man, but mm-hmm. what does that mean in Eritrea, and what does that mean in the United States, and how do you reconcile all of that? So I think that, you know, the stress that our men face is real. We know this. We know this. And what's frightening, I think, is that sometimes it doesn't meet the eye. You know, so in the case of Figre, you know, the most beautiful, luminous, trim, light-filled, bouncing, head-standing, you know, downward-facing
right.
dog, you know, person you could ever want to encounter, filled with beauty and light. But to think that inside his body was metabolizing stress in a very different way, I think we have to take care of ourselves and each other. And I think what gives me comfort, even though his loss was catastrophic, like so many of these losses, is that he loved and was 100% at peace within family and with his work.
Yes, and you talk about
so
that too.
I'm you know, I'm grateful for that.
Right, and it comes across the love. I think there was one section where you found the poem that he wrote for your children.
Yes.
And the importance and the value of family.
Yeah, that was
and children.
When my first son, our sons came to us very quickly and in quick succession. And, you know, this was, we were both all in and joyful to be parents, and so I found this this beautiful, beautiful poem that he wrote when our son Solomon was a young boy, a baby, and we were looking at the world through his eyes, and he says, "This is what it is like to ride with my son, seeing the invisible. My son, who is 1 year and 10 months, who has all of his teeth, who is peaceful, who is full of wonders and song."
Beautiful, beautiful. Now, just switching up a bit, you have managed to combine the writing life and the parenting life and the teaching life. How do you do that? That is a challenge. I'm still working on that.
I think it's always a work in process, and I could say with a chuckle, you know, well, I'm a Gemini, and so that means that we always have to have more than one thing going on at the same time. But I do think that the different pieces for me, though my life is always a little bit chaotic and there's always a ball that's dropping as I'm picking up another ball, the pieces are very, very complementary. To have the internal space that it takes to write, to be able to make that space to listen to myself, to have the privilege and pleasure and challenge of raising my sons, I couldn't imagine what life would be like without that daily joy of them and interestingness of them. And, you know, I've taught for decades now, and my students, you know, sharing, our culture with them, sharing the great voices, mostly in writing, but also in painting and in dance and in film, of our tradition with young people, and seeing them get excited and seeing them look into the work and pull out so much and give me new ideas. That is a wonderful way. And building African American studies, which I've done very diligently at Yale, that's, I've got to belong to a community. And so teaching and the world of African American studies has let me belong to community. So I need all the pieces. I think that they feed each other.
I understand that. Mm-hmm. So when you look at what's happening in poetry, particularly, I should say, African American literature, what are your views on the future and the future of publishing and expanding the canon even more?
Yes, well, when I was in graduate school and starting off as a writer in the 80s, a lot of the scholarly work on black literature was being done on fiction. You know, that was, of course, the period where black women's fiction was getting all kinds of wonderful and well-deserved attention. And there was also a lot of historical archival work happening, you know, texts being dug up from the 19th century that we didn't know existed and doing the historical work around those texts. And so that was great. I think now we are absolutely in the age and flourishing of black poetry. I think that, first of all, if you take institutional measures and just look at where people are teaching, who's winning prizes, what publishing houses are publishing our work that absolutely never would have published our work before. So that the result is that our work has much more widespread availability, and our mentoring is much more widely available, and we are teaching the tradition where we are. I think it's been an absolute explosion, and I can't, you know, as a literary historian, I can't imagine that anyone can look or will look back at these years as not being fundamentally about this explosion in the poetry, that that's where the action is, that that's where the powerful voices are, and it is an amazing, amazing time. I couldn't even start to name the names of the extraordinary books that are coming out. I can't believe, you know, a book will come out and I'll say, I don't know who this is, or even more, I don't know that person. You know how it, well, right. You know, used to be you knew everybody.
But now, yes. But isn't it still also a challenge, though, to even though we have in the literary world and in the world of poetry, you have many more people writing and being acknowledged and winning prizes. Isn't it still more of a challenge for poets to get their books sold, to be heard?
I think it will always be more of a challenge for us, and I think that also for poets in general. And I think of, you know, our great elders, our great ancestors like Baraka, like Lucille Clifton, and how, you know, as you know, Baraka always had a tote bag of his books with him.
That's right.
You know, just that sense that as poets, and particularly as Black poets, that you always are somewhat responsible for peddling your wares, right. That you can't expect any institution to take care of it. So is it harder? Yes. Is it harder for poets? Yes. I think, though, also it's worth mentioning that the internet has been really, really good and used innovatively, I think, by poets and by Black poets. You know, there's a portability to poems that I think is very well suited to zooming all around the internet. So when I think about something like, you know, the Black Poets Speak movement on Twitter, following, you know, so many horrors of the
right.
last year
yes.
in particular, but mm-hmm. This was, I think, most immediately following Eric Garner's killing, and that, you know, poets just turned their cell phones to themselves and recited poems by other Black poets and sent those out by Twitter and by on other social media. I think that that's an exciting way that we have taken good advantage of getting our work around. So, I mean, the struggle is always there, bias is always there, unfairness is always there, but I think that we are really, really, really making the most of the moment.
Well, I thank you. Believe it or not, we are almost at a close. And as we come to a close, I want to remind our listening audience to please go out and purchase The Light of the World. It's again, to me, it's the kind of book that you can have by your bedside and go back to. But I also would like you to share with emerging poets and with our listeners a message that you would like to convey to them, either about your memoir or about poetry or writing.
Well, thank you for that invitation. And it would be about life, and it's a message from my father, actually, who always said to me, always speak up, always speak for justice. You may not know who's listening, but someone is always listening, and someone needs to hear your voice. And I think that is advice that has applicability in a lot of different directions, and just that's the message of power that I want to share from my daddy.
Well, thank you so much, Professor Alexander. Thank you for writing The Light of the World and for inspiring us and illustrating your journey.
Well, thank you. This has been a rich and beautiful conversation, as I knew it would be. So thank you for all that you do, and thank you for bringing me to your listeners.
You're welcome. And remember, I'd like to thank my engineer, Fritz. And remember, the writer is always reading. The reader is always writing. Keep reading and writing. Empower yourselves as readers and writers. And we're going out with Gary Bartz's I've Known Rivers.
Perfect.
Okay.
Inspired by a poem written by Langston Hughes. I'm sure most of you have heard of Langston Hughes. And he wrote a poem about rivers.